It's time for Michigan Sports Talk Morning Show, broadcasting live all across the state of Michigan and Northwest Ohio. This is X's and Bros.
It out to Sadiq Bey. Defending
him to Abdul Rahman at midcourt. Extra pass.
And it goes for the win. The three-pointer by Jordan Poole.
Here's the give. Walker.
Danny Walker. That's down. Smarty.
Goff's got it. Back. Looks. Throws. And so.
Yes. Caught. Touchdown to Troy Myers. They did it. Amon-Ra St. Brown in the receiving end.
Sends one to deep left center field. Back it goes, and that ball's
out of here. A grand slam from Miguel Cabrera. He's got two goals. Larkin in on goal. Scores! His first career hat trick in his seventh season for Dylan Larkin.
Here's your host, Anthony Bellino.
Rise and shine, folks. Good Wednesday morning to you. It is the 20th day of March, 2024. Wow. Time flies when you're having fun. I still can't believe we're this far along. Isn't that incredible? We welcome you here to X's and Bros on the Michigan Sports and Network. Ben Glaze, Ryan Elke, Anthony Bellino, all joining you. Thank you for joining us, no matter who you are, where you are, how you may be listening, all across the great state of Michigan and in Northwest Ohio and worldwide on the iHeartRadio app. We say good morning to you. We welcome you. We thank you. We appreciate you. And, of course, we encourage you. Join the program at any time. You can text the keyword sports radio and send that to 21,000. Sports radio to 21000. Our Meyer Supercenter guest line, 866-838-4843. That's 866-838-4843. We're on Twitter at XB Mornings, Facebook X's and Bros, and of course, good morning to our television audience as well on BCSN and streaming live on our YouTube page at Michigan Sports Network. Add a .com to that to find our website. XBMornings@gmail.com is our fan feedback email inbox. You can find us all individually on Twitter. Ben Glaze is at the Ben Glaze. Ryan Elke is at Ryan L underscore Key, and I'm Anthony Bellino at AC Bellino. Gentlemen, good morning to both of you. How are we on this Wednesday? It is hump day.
That's right. Good morning. Doing well.
Do anything fun yesterday?
No. Just relaxed.
Said no. Like I was like a teacher. Like I was looking to send you to detention. Said no, sir. There was no fun, sir.
No,
we don't have fun.
Yeah. We just relaxed.
Well, it was a. It's a good day. Good day in sports. First four. Red Wings win. Oh, yeah. It was a good day in sports yesterday. Look a little shaky. Little shaky for those Wingdings. And then, of course, with the first four, the excitement and the jubilation of winning your conference tournament or getting an automatic qualifying position and... You know, that's on Sunday. You roll around. You got to get to Dayton, Ohio, and get ready to go for a game on Tuesday. And some of those teams are ready. Some of those teams were not. And the Wagner versus Howard game offered us a pretty fun opener to the 2024 tournament. And then there was the boat race that turned into Colorado State and a just very ill-prepared Virginia team. I don't know if they thought they were just going to walk in there and have a good time, but Colorado State walked in there like their house was on fire, ready to go. And, you know, at one point, there was an 0 for 14 shooting stretch for Virginia, which included 0 for 5 from 3. You're never going to survive that. You just can't. It's impossible. And that's exactly what had happened. So it's pretty... It's pretty interesting here. For the first four, and we open things up, and we get kind of the best of both worlds, which is really fun. And we're also, you know, very excited about the rest of the week. That's going to be very, very interactive. Coming up on today's program, my conversation with Kevin Pauga from Michigan State University. He's the associate AD there, but also works with this development of the KPI and what that means and the metrics that go into college basketball and all of these different elements that are at play on Selection Sunday when trying to put together your field of 64 plus 4 or field of 68. So we'll get that conversation in, and then we'll talk about those games last night, the Red Wings, do a couple segments on the Wings, and then last night from the 30,000 feet view with Colorado State boat racing Virginia by 25 points, that as well. Where is Greg Sankey at to look at that? An ACC team getting housed by the Mountain West. That is not what Mr. Sankey had in mind. But first, we'll get you all caught up with all the happenings across the world of sports. We'll do so right now in the headlines.
Big news.
I have a little news flash.
Let's check the headlines.
No, it's real news for once.
The biggest stories of the local, regional, and national news.
This is huge news.
Huge news. All right, we're going to start in the world of the National Football League. Romeo Okwara has called it quits after 8 seasons in the National Football League. He has decided to step away. After some introspection and meditation, I've decided to step away from the NFL. The game of football has been the largest part of my life for the greater of 18 years, 8 of which I've been fortunate enough to play at the professional level, 4 of those with my brother. The experiences, the friendships, camaraderie I've been lucky enough to share with my teammates, coaches, and peers is something I will forever be grateful for. You all mean the world to me, and I will continue to cheer you on for the rest of our lives. The 28-year-old appeared in 16 games for the Lions this past season. He had 9 tackles, 5 quarterback hits, and a pair of sacks. He was set to become a free agent, and he's just done. My heart is forever with you and the city of Detroit, he said. His 23 career sacks also rank as the 4th most by an NFL player born in Nigeria. Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou, Romeo? He's out. Jimmy Garoppolo said he messed up, and the Rams actually seem right. And I saw the picture. I was like, oh, Jimmy G with the LA Rams. Jimmy G is a Los Angeles Ram. He's there as the backup quarterback. Said that Tuesday his 2-game suspension for violating the NFL's performance enhancing substance policy was because he messed up the therapeutic use exemption when he first got to Vegas. The violation was related to the quarterback using prescribed medication without having a valid therapeutic use exemption from the league. You know, look, good. I'm just whatever. I don't even know what that means. Nor am I really that interested in it. I'm just glad that he came out and gave us a reason as to why. It's not as if, if he was like on the juice or something. Okay. I just want to know. I don't want to speculate. So at least now we know what it is. So he will back up Matthew Stafford with the L.A. Rams after he was released by the Las Vegas Raiders. The Browns have signed wide receiver Jerry Jeudy to a 3-year, $58 million extension. That sounds like a lot of money for Jerry Jeudy. 3 years, $58 million. I don't think you can get Amon-Ra St. Brown that cheap. I mean, the average annual value is 20. Right? Less than 20. So I really don't think. I think Amon-Ra is going to be more expensive than that. And I know that scares a lot of people. The Jets have signed ex-Chargers wide receiver Mike Williams. So he gets a 1-year deal. The value of $15 million with incentives. Chase Young is going to have a neck procedure and miss part of camp. Maybe this is why he was sitting on the shelf for so long. But he did sign a 1-year deal guaranteed for $13 million. Did the Saints know about this ahead of time? That's the really interesting part I would like to know. I'd really like to know. Young isn't the only Saints player not expected to be ready for training camp at the time. Linebacker Nephi Sewell, the brother of Penei Sewell, tore his ACL last fall, also expected to be a little bit late on the arrival. USA men's basketball has pulled Serbia in their group play, so they are still kind of way they're Americans were drawn into Group C for the Olympic pool play, which starts on July 27th. So Serbia is in there, and they're also waiting to figure out who else. South Sudan is in there, and then Puerto Rico, Italy, Lithuania are all candidates to get the fourth spot, which we'll figure out at some point somewhere along the line. And the Red Wings, 4-3 winners last night in overtime with Patrick Kane. Plenty to talk about with that game. Coming up next here on X's and Bros on the Michigan Sports Network.
Huge here for the Michigan High School Athletic Association. You can stay up to date on the latest from Lansing 24/7 at MHSAA.com, at MHSAA on Twitter, and MHSAA on Facebook. The latest news, press releases, and stories connected to every high school in the state of Michigan, available for you 24/7 from the Michigan High School Athletic Association. Log on to MHSAA.com, at MHSAA on Twitter, and MHSAA on Facebook. And if you're looking for archive, boys and girls, high school sports, MHSAA.tv. That's MHSAA.tv. 24/7, everything you need to know about high school sports in Michigan. Log on to MHSAA.com.
Time out. The super sale is back at Meijer, Friday and Saturday only. Coca-Cola 2 liters are $1.49, Frank's Red Hot Sauce is $2.99, and Pace Salsa is just $1.49. Plus, get chicken wings, pre-made snack trays, and fresh and ready deli items to enjoy during the games. Meijer's Super Sale deals are in-store and online while supplies last. Shop this Friday and Saturday only during the Meijer Super Sale. Okay, game on. Exclusions apply. See all the deals in the Meijer app.
Roast Umber is a farm-direct coffee sourced from Central American farmers and roasted in Grand Rapids. And also the Nitro Cold Brew Coffee is a convenient and healthy option for energy with no sugar additives. Look for it at your local retailer or at roastumber.com.
From Traverse City to the Glass City, GR to the Motor City, you're listening to X's and Bros on the Michigan Sports Network.
Welcome back here to X's and Bros, Michigan Sports Network. Great to have you riding along with us, no matter who you are, where you are, how you may be listening, all across the great state of Michigan and Northwest Ohio and worldwide. The iHeartRadio app, you text the keyword sports radio and send that to 21,000 sports radio to 21000. Our Meijer Supercenter guest line, 866-838-4843. That's 866-838-4843. Last night, Bally Sports Detroit. The Red Wings were in action taking on the Columbus Blue Jackets. And the Blue Jackets were 23-34-12 on the year. They were 33 losses, or I should say 23-34-11 going into last night's game. The Wings 34-28-6 going into last night's game. The Wings needed to take care of business. They were up 2-0 in the season series against the Blue Jackets in their final tilt against Columbus. Columbus sitting at the bottom of the barrel in the Eastern Conference, the worst team in the entire conference, not just the Metro Division, but with 58 points, that puts them dead last in the East. After Columbus at 58 points, it goes Ottawa at 60, Montreal at 62, Pittsburgh at 69, and then Buffalo at 71. This was a must-win game for the Detroit Red Wings in which they came out and looked awful. They looked awful last night. And it was really very shocking at how poorly they played in that first period. Now, I get that everybody's an NHL player. I get that. I am not, you know, I don't want to disregard that at all because I don't think that that is intelligent. I also don't think that's right. However, this is a game that you have to win because with the team at the bottom of the standings like that, like you gotta be able to win a game. Here's Coach Stallone after the game last night.
How much of what we saw in that first period gets washed away with the end result here tonight?
I don't know. I was flabbergasted. I was shocked, disappointed. I never thought with this group that it felt like they quit, and I couldn't believe it. We talked it through the first, and how much adversity and bounce back this group has shown this year, how much this group has shown in the 2 years I've been here. I couldn't believe it. And they didn't quit, obviously. Huge credit to the guys, the pushback in the second, and then obviously to hang in there and not to quit right to the end and get the full 2 points.
That's a pretty bold statement there from Coach Lalone. In that first period, they just looked, they looked slow. They looked disorganized. They didn't look like they were ready to play, in my opinion. And then to hear him say, like, nah, all this time, all these comeback victories, you know, never expected this group, you know, for me to feel like this group quit. And it was like, wow, that's pretty shocking. And I'm glad that Max Boltman had put the entire quote out there on the internet, because you know how it goes without hearing the full context of the, first off, the question. Secondly, the full response there from Derek Lalone. People will cherry pick a word or a few words and move forward with their own created narrative. So I'm glad that I'm glad Max put that out there for the Twitterverse to see, and not just Coach Lalone thought his guys quit. Okay, all right. So that's, oh, and then what? You know what I mean? Like you need more than that. So, you know, hopefully for people that, you know, saw that and people that hear it this morning, they understand the full depth of the quote that this team just, you know, first period last night, they looked god awful. And I did not have a very good feeling about anything regarding this team and at the end of the first period. I mean, that was bad. That was bad. And it wasn't just 1-0. I mean, it was 2-0. 2-0 at the end of the first, and it's like, do I even have to watch the rest of this? Are we done here? You know, and also we have the stadium series at Ohio Stadium, the Wings and Blue Jackets next year. So that'll take place and everybody will be real fun. You know, everybody will be real excited about that. You know, the outdoor hockey game. It's more of a novelty than anything else. But, hey, you know, it's a, yeah, it's outdoor hockey. And like I said, it's kind of a novelty thing. It's 2-0 Columbus. We're in the second period, early stages. We'll pick things up 17:06. Wings on the power play.
Kane with it now. Top of the right circle. Down low, back in front. They score! Raymond! A new career high for him, and it's 2-1.
You know, he's one of those guys that's been a little bit, I don't want to say forgotten about, but because of DeBrincat, because of Kane, because of Larkin, they get most of the headlines, and we, you know, most people talk about them. But I really think that, I mean, if anybody's earned a massive contract, it's that guy right there. I mean, Lucas Raymond has been dynamite. So that happens, and there's, you know, hell, I don't know. There's probably... what do I want to say time-wise, you know, he scores and it's, you know, less than 3 minutes into the period. So just over 17 minutes to play. And then his running mate, Mo Sider, he's like, Mo has seen enough. It's 2-1, pick things up at 15:42, same period. Wings just got on the board. Here's Moritz.
Between the first and the second in the room. Oh, they score! What the hell? Kicked in by Columbus.
I think so.
Yep, and it's a 2-2 tie. Whatever was said is working.
I think it was Gabrantz's left skate.
That's a kicking motion, but from the right team.
Boy, oh boy. That is the break that I was talking about earlier in the first period.
Puck luck, right? I mean, that's what it is. It's getting the right bounce at the right time. You tie things up at 2 apiece. Happy 57th birthday, by the way, to the great Vladimir Konstantinov. Vladdy, 57 years old. Very, very exciting stuff there. And then, of course, last night, the Columbus Blue Jackets would take the lead 3-2. We have 17.4 seconds left to play. When this happens, in regulation...
Scrambled faceoff. DeBrincat gets it back to Gosselin. Spinning across. Now Kane. Save River. They score! Raymond! Wow. Boy, does everybody love Raymond now!
12.6 seconds left. And all off the faceoff.
I tell you what. I mean, Ken Daniels. God bless him. I just go losing his mind up there. Love every second of it. And then it's like, okay, overtime. This is it. 3-on-3. We'll pick things up. 4 minutes, 17 seconds to go, right? We're just a measly 43 seconds in. Showtime.
Sider drops it back to Brinkett to Kane. Kane's right in. Shooting with Trinta. He scores! Patrick Kane! Showtime does it again!
Big time goal. Net comes off its moorings. Crowd's going crazy. Listen to those people. Listen to them. Horns going off. Everybody's happy. Everybody loves Raymond. Patrick Kane gets his 15th of the season in overtime. Clutch, to say the least. And that's how this team comes up with a victory. You needed a goal at the end of regulation. You had to get one in overtime because it didn't really feel like it came out with that much juice ready to go in period number one. And they found a way to win a game that they absolutely needed to. Absolutely needed to. And, you know, I think about the Columbus second goal where Reimer was just beat. But, I mean, to give up the puck as a defenseman, to give up the puck at the blue line of the offensive zone and know that you got nobody behind you and you just get your pocket picked and then a breakaway, you can't catch the guy. I mean, stuff like that just can't happen. There are definitely going to be some changes on the roster, but it's got to be the right time to do it. Regardless, the Red Wings win. Everybody's happy. We'll step aside. My conversation with Kevin Pauga coming up next.
Bill Simonson here for my good friend Josh Garvey. Now, he's a managing shareholder at Dorn Mayhew's Grand Rapids office. Their world headquarters are in Troy, Michigan, on the east side of the state, and they have locations all around the world. They have over 550 motivated accounting professionals, 90 years in business, and I mentioned the 10 offices worldwide. So if you want to connect and partner with one of the top CPA accounting and business firms in the world, they're right here in Michigan. Dorn Mayhew's Troy office on the east side of the state, and Josh Garvey is a managing shareholder for their Dorn Mayhew GR office. Right there by the S-curve, you'll see the new Dorn Mayhew sign. You can find out more. Just Google Dorn Mayhew. That's DoreenMayhew or Dorn.com. They're one of America's and the world's top CPA accounting and business firms. They're Dorn Mayhew.
Leonard Skinner. ZZ Top. Friday, August 9th at Soaring Eagle Casino. The Sharp Dressed Simple Man Tour. Leonard Skinner and ZZ Top. Tickets start at $38 and are on sale now at the box office and etix.com. Part of the Soaring Eagle Summer Outdoor Concert Series. Leonard Skinner and ZZ Top. Friday, August 9th at Soaring Eagle Casino and Resort.
Roast Umber is a farm-direct coffee sourced from Central American farmers and roasted in Grand Rapids. And also the Nitro Cold Brew Coffee is a convenient and healthy option for energy with no sugar additives. Look for it at your local retailer or at roastumber.com. Coming up later today at 3 on the Huge Show on the Michigan Sports Network, I'll deliver huge opinions on everything you're talking about.
This is X's and Bros on the Michigan Sports Network.
Because it's all about the metrics. His name is Kevin Pauga. You can find him on Twitter at Kevin Pauga. He's the Associate Athletic Director for Strategic Initiatives and Conference Planning at Michigan State University. Kevin, good evening to you, my friend. How are you? How's life? How are things, partner?
I'm good. Good, guys.
We're doing well. Yes. I mean, life is good, right? Yes. We got the bracket all figured out. I got to know first in your title, what does Strategic Initiatives and Conference Planning mean?
Yeah, so the day job is Associate AD at Michigan State. A lot to do with basketball, a lot to do with logistics, a lot to do with scheduling as well. So that's kind of the day job, but then also certainly KPI and some different things scheduling-wise come into play additionally.
You know, the question I wanted to ask, are you dealing with a lot of analytics, Kevin? Has analytics just really kind of taken over some of the things that you're doing or things that you're responsible for?
Yeah, so analytics, think of it this way, that data analytics math is still intended to be a resource. Think of it just from whether we're talking on the court in basketball, whether we're talking scheduling, whether we're talking even team travel, logistics, all those things. You're really just measuring probabilities, and you're, hey, are we more likely to be this or that, and then have it inform your decision-making in kind of the grand scheme. So whether that's a point guard deciding what shot to take or what pass to make, or in this vein, kind of deciding which team to schedule, what you're trying to do is you're trying to use those resources to help inform your decision-making, not necessarily have the math always make your decision.
Ooh, I like that, Kevin. I like that. I like that a lot because I'm so fascinated by the numbers. I have to know, at what point did you decide, like, hey, I'm going to dive in, you know, deeper to this. I want to turn my love for the numbers, the love for the data, into something that Tom Izzo can walk down the hallway and pound on the door and ask me a question.
Yeah. So I was the kid that charted the Major League Baseball schedule to try and figure out where the patterns were, and at that time, how do you get from Milwaukee to Chicago, and how do you get from Philadelphia to New York or whatever it was? Those patterns always intrigued me, and so to be able to kind of mix as a kid my love for kind of the logic problem, the problem solving, along with sports was always really intriguing. And so it kind of grew from there, but certainly as a kid, it was always something that was very intriguing to me.
Yeah. Kevin, I wanted to ask you, what approach have you guys taken from a sports standpoint with kind of what has gone on with MSU, you know, the shooting, you know, just other things, and you guys dealing with the students, you guys dealing with student athletes. Has that been a certain approach that you guys have taken?
Yeah, so I'm a little less involved with the on-court stuff nowadays. Certainly in my video coordinator days and director of ops, I was probably a little bit more involved there. But as a general rule of thumb, think of it this way, that you're trying to take a total number of possessions, and you're trying to net out where your average points per possession is versus where your defensive points per possessions are. So if on average it's about 1.04 points per possession is kind of average in college basketball on the men's side. So how do we take the expected points off of any given shot and maximize the number of opportunities that exceed that 1.04? So a layup, for instance, you figure you're going to make a layup 95% of the time if it's uncontested. That would be the equivalent of about 1.9 points per possession. So on average, if you want to just take kind of across the board, 33% from three-point range is equivalent to about 50% from two-point range, notwithstanding a layup versus a deep three and kind of all the intricacies that come into that. So if you're kind of thinking in that vein when you're taking a shot as to what a quality shot is versus what it's not, it can kind of give you some perspective as to what the expected points per possession are based on any outcome.
When you're getting this up and running, and for all of our listeners, you can visit KPI Sports on Twitter or X, whatever you call it, at KPI Sports, and learn more about it. Sportico also just did a great great article on you as well. So congrats to that in the last couple of days. But at what point were you kind of like, wow, okay, here I am. I have all of these numbers and all of this data, and I want to take this to the next level. Like, I'm gonna turn this into something.
You know what? Honest to goodness, there hasn't necessarily been a plan. It's kind of been kind of, hey, as things evolve, as things grow, as people understand what I think I know what I'm talking about, and probably some moments where I don't know what I'm talking about. That's kind of how that's evolved, and certainly some things have changed over times. Just to, the scheduling during COVID, for instance, was something that that changed some things. Realignment has certainly changed some things on the scheduling front, and so being able to adapt and react has probably been a skill that I'm not sure that I ever knew that I needed it, and I'm maybe not sure some days how good I am at it, but it's certainly something that that is valuable, kind of as the college sports world evolves, and frankly, the way that we play basketball, the way that we play football also evolves as well.
Yeah. Kev, I wanted to know how are you guys navigating the landscape of the conference now? I mean, a lot of big changes coming to the conference. How are you guys planning on navigating that?
Yeah, so from the Big Ten perspective, this is the last academic year as a 14-team conference. Oregon, Washington, UCLA, and USC will join in all the sports that they sponsor starting next academic year, the 24-25 season. So the football schedule's out and is public. You're going to see the remaining sports kind of be released over time. But there's been a lot of mock schedules built. There's been a lot of information that we can ingest into the computer, everything ranging from competitive balance to travel distances to where are the major airports located to game times, to television, and missed class time relative to fall breaks, to winter breaks, any and every bit of information that we can obtain that's going to make that experience as positive as can be for everybody involved, student-athletes, coaches, fans, et cetera. We like to think that we've ingested a lot of it into the computer model that's spitting schedules out. We know that there's certainly some things that are going to be learned over these first few years that hopefully can be additive to the process as it continues to evolve.
It is simply incredible. And with March on the horizon, right, we start to take a look around. It's like what conference has what teams in this grand ball. And you look at the four Pac-12 teams that made it in comparison relative to the six Big Ten teams, right? And we're trying to take a look at the KPI. We're looking at Bart Torvik. We're looking at KenPom rankings. Was there an inspiration? Do you look at KenPom? Do you look at Bart Torvik? Are you kind of like in that mix where like, hey, I want to see what else is going on and how, you know, our system kind of stacks up to theirs?
Yeah, for sure. And it's important to define what each system's trying to represent too. So think of it this way, in kind of the context of men's basketball, you've got the net, which is intended as a primary sorting tool. So at no point has the NCAA ever come out and said, hey, we're going to select the top 45 teams from the net. The net is intended to be a qualitative measure as to how good a team is, and you build your resume by playing net quality teams. Beyond that, there's two buckets of metrics. You've got your results-based metrics, which KPI and strength of record fall into that bucket. And then you've got more your predictive-based metrics, which that's where KenPom and BPI fall in. Results-based is how good is your resume, and predictive is how good is your team. So when there's a difference between the two, there's a difference between team resume and team quality. That's coming into play that helps to be able to articulate context as to where a team falls. So when I'm looking at KenPom, for instance, that's telling me, hey, this team is the 20th best team or the 20th most efficient team, and here's why, and it's digging into that. Whereas KPI is trying to define, was it harder for me to go 20-11 against my schedule or for you to go 23-8 against your schedule? And so those are two different questions, both valuable questions, both important bits of information, but they're different definitions, and often I'll explain why there's intended to be some differences in terms of the two metrics.
Yeah. Kevin, I just want to know your feelings about this year's basketball team, MSU basketball team. Wanted to know about the seeding, where they at. What's your thoughts on them getting through this? Just your thoughts in general about MSU basketball this year.
Yeah, certainly excited. 26 straight NCAA tournaments is quite a feat. The great thing about the draw, you certainly know who the first round game is, and for Michigan State, mm-hmm. that's against Mississippi State on Thursday in Charlotte. But we all know that that the bracket evolves. And you can certainly try to define what the path is now, if you were fortunate enough to win that first game. But there's certainly a lot of instances where the path that you think that you're going to need to take versus the actual path and the teams in front of you, that there's going to be a reset. So, for those that may think that they're overseeded or underseeded, some of it's going to reset depending on who's upset. And now all of a sudden, if you're a four seed and you think you got a real rough five seed, but 12 beats five, you might be able to get to a Sweet 16 by playing a 13 and 12. And so, depending on kind of how things play out, different teams are going to have different matchups, and that's what we enjoy about, especially this first weekend, where Thursday and Friday games are just lined up all day, and we're sure to have different storylines coming from different places. You never know where they're going to come from and kind of where they're going to expose themselves.
It truly is, Kevin, one of the most wonderful times of the year for any sports fan, especially those of us that, you know, love college basketball. Now to the big one, right? Because a lot of folks want to know, I am one of these people. One, do we have the right people in the room picking this bracket? Do we need more people like Kevin Pauga in the room to get this sorted out? Because Lomas and I are looking at each other while you're talking. It's like, holy mackerel, this is a ton of information. So one, do we have the right room? And two, Michigan State versus Kansas State head-to-head resume. That one looked a little dicey.
Yeah, so let me take the second part first. And I think that I know about the graphic that you're referencing that hit social media this weekend. And my one point there is that you can make anybody look different by adding or omitting rows of data. And so it's important. I actually made the point to somebody that if I was to take Michigan State and Wisconsin and put certain rows of data, I could make the two of those teams look very much alike as well. But I think that all three of us would agree that Wisconsin was rightfully several seed lines ahead of Michigan State, given everything else that was going on. And so that's where, in that particular graphic, you want to have the results-based metrics on there as well. You want to have additional context behind what's going on. And so to cherry pick certain bits of information, that's where you get in trouble. And so to be able to kind of look at that in the full context is certainly important. I'll tell you this, just relative to selecting the field, there's a lot of conversation and a lot of work that goes on during the spring, summer, and fall, during the basketball off season, in terms of education on the metrics and what each one means and what do you need to do and what is the value of winning this game versus losing that game and to help inform coaches and administrators and everybody that's involved. It is a nonstop process. I can tell you, just speaking for myself, the number of Zoom calls, et cetera, that I take part in order to try and contribute to that is certainly numerous.
Yeah.
In general, look, there's always going to be some arguments around the cut line, but where I think that a lot of the discussion has come over the last 24 hours is that cut line was very compressed. Because NC State won the ACC and Oregon won the Pac-12, and so where that cut those first four teams out of the tournament, based on where the cut line was last year, based on who won the conference tournaments, all four of those teams would have been in the field last year, and so we kind of lose perspective when we've got a tighter bubble, one of the tightest ever, to be able to offer that. The last thing I'll leave you with is that out of the 32 conference champions, 27 of them would not have made the NCAA tournament without winning their conference tournament. And that's everything from the 16 seed all the way to up to NC State and everything in between. That number's normally in kind of the 21-22 range. And so to have that big of a difference and have those first four games play into a 10 seed really presented a different dynamic that frankly, coaches, administrators, fans haven't seen since the tournament field expanded to 68 13 years ago.
His name is Kevin Pauga, folks. Yes. I'm telling you what, this guy.
No.
I mean, that is on. Find him on Twitter at Kevin Pauga. Check out at KPI Sports as well. Check out the new article in Sportico breaking down all of this as well in Kevin's journey here. And Kevin, I was so excited to. I emailed Max earlier today and I said, Max, can we get Kevin on? We gotta crunch some numbers. Thank you so much for your time this evening. Such an informative conversation. I love it. Thank you.
Appreciate it, Kevin.
Great to be with you guys. Thanks so much.
So my conversation there with Kevin Pauga, and I hope that that helps a little bit. Maybe I'll be able to do some more of that. Not sure if I'll be able to do more of that, but I saw it. You know what? It wasn't too terrible. Seemed to work out right there. What do you think, Ben? I think that worked out okay.
Yeah, it went well.
Yeah. Yeah. We didn't have any technological clusters there, so that was good. We'll be able to, you know, have some different conversations, if you will, and some of the different ones from the evening that I can bring here to the mornings. And it's when you look at the data of everything, and this is what Greg Sankey is looking at is a little bit different than how we are viewing things. And I want to get more into this later on in the show, because I don't want people to, how do I put this? We talk a lot about college sports here on this program because I like college sports. I don't necessarily like the direction that they are going, but I've always liked college sports. It's a shame when Kirby Smart has to come out and talk about if a guy's going to forego his senior year of high school because he's already committed that he doesn't want him on his team. It's a shame that the state of Florida, I think the state of Michigan, maybe Pennsylvania have already tried to take a dive into high school NIL. And when you have the freedom of choice for high schools and kids transferring left and right, probably one of the best players, one of the best basketball players in Southeast Michigan or Northwest Ohio is a young fellow by the name of Jerry Easter. Jerry Easter left Ohio to go play at La Lumiere. And, you know, that's the IMG Academy in Florida, like all of this stuff, like how everything has changed from what it once was. Does it ever cycle back? Does it ever turn? Does the pendulum ever swing back? Or is this not like a trend from a pendulum standpoint? Is this more of like the toothpaste being out of the tube? And we've seen it, and we've seen it develop. We've had kids, you know, parents transfer and, you know, change addresses and use like a relative's address so that the kid can go to a different high school. And all of that stuff has kind of been in play for quite some time, but it's just different in today's world. And we talk a lot of college sports here because I enjoy them, and I hope that you enjoy them as well, whether you're on the Michigan State side or if you're on the Michigan side or you're just a fan in general. It's a lot of fun to razz each other back and forth about our teams. But then also what Greg Sankey is saying from a broader perspective and how, you know, colleges are changing even more. I put this poll question out. It's got a ton of votes, and I want to get your thoughts on it as well. I'll retweet it right now if you're on the Twitterverse. But I just want to know, like, are you as a fan going to donate directly to your favorite college team's NIL collective? Are you going to write a check to Sparty's World or Valiant or whatever your collective is called? I want to talk a little bit about that as well. We'll be back hour two next. X's and Bros, Michigan Sports Network.
Time out. The super sale is back at Meijer, Friday and Saturday only. Coca-Cola 2 liters are $1.49, Frank's Red Hot Sauce is $2.99, and Pace Salsa is just $1.49. Plus, get chicken wings, pre-made snack trays, and fresh and ready deli items to enjoy during the games. Meijer's super sale deals are in-store and online while supplies last. Shop this Friday and Saturday only during the Meijer super sale. Okay, game on. Exclusions apply. See all the deals in the Meijer app.
Bill Simonson here for Flying Ace Craft Spirits. You can chart your own course with small batch American-made whiskeys. And also they're connected to Folds of Honor here in Michigan, providing 4 scholarships this year through Flying Ace Craft Spirits to the children of men and women injured or killed in combat. Look for Flying Ace Craft Spirits and that small batch American-made whiskeys in different flavors at local stores, or ask for it at your local pub, bar, or restaurant.
Flying Ace exists at the intersection of independence and precision. They distill fine spirits for Mavericks, the adventurous, the cunning, and the bold. You can find out more and also order online if you're 21 and up at flyingacespirits.com or look for it in stores all across Michigan or at your local bar, pub, or restaurant.
Hey, Michigan, let's go big. I'm Herman Moore, Lions All-Pro wide receiver, and I'm talking real big-time winning on the hottest slots and table games on one incredible app, Eagle Casino and Sports.
Sign up now and get up to $1,500. That's right. We'll match your deposit for up to $1,500, and you'll get 100 free spins.
Eagle Casino and Sports. Made in Michigan. Made for Michigan.
Must be 21 or older and in Michigan to play.
Huge here for Van Andel Institute Purple Community. Now, they're a grassroots fundraising network powered by the volunteers who support VAI's mission to improve health now and in the future. Learn more at purplecommunity.org.
The Freddy the Pizza Man Foundation is dedicated to providing support to families and Michigan schools touched by autism. We invite you to join us in supporting these families and schools by making a donation at freddythepizzaman.com. With your donation, you can help provide essential resources that can make a real impact. Visit freddythepizzaman.com to make a donation and to learn more about the foundation's mission. That's F-R-E-D-I, thepizzaman.com. Together, we can make a difference.
Huge here. AB's doing a heck of a job, and I'm ready to drop some huge opinions about what he's talking about later today at 3 on the Michigan Sports Network.
Good morning, everyone.
It's time for Michigan Sports Talk Morning Show, broadcasting live all across the state of Michigan and Northwest Ohio. This is X's and Br0's.
How are you?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's a good morning. Wake up to a brand new day.
Hello. Good morning.
Good morning, Vietnam.
Here's your host, Anthony Bellino.
Rise and shine, folks. Welcome back here. Hour number two on this Wednesday. It is the 20th day of March, 2024. Great to have you riding along with us, no matter who you are, where you are, how you may be listening all across the great state of Michigan and in Northwest Ohio and worldwide on the iHeartRadio app. Say good morning to you. We welcome you. We thank you. We appreciate you. And, of course, we encourage you. Join the program at any time. You can text the keyword sports radio. Send that to 21000. Sports radio to 21000. Our Meyer Supercenter guest line, 866-838-4843, 866-838-4843. We're on Twitter at XB Mornings, Facebook, X's and Br0's, and of course, good morning to our television audience as well on BCSN and streaming live on our YouTube page at Michigan Sports Network. Add a .com to that to find our website. XBMornings at gmail.com is our fan feedback email inbox, and find us all individually on Twitter. Ben Glaze is at the Ben Glaze. Ryan Elke is at Ryan_Key. And I'm Anthony Bellino at AC Bellino. What's going on in the world of sports? We'll try to get you all caught up with all the happenings. We'll do so right now in the headlines.
Big news.
I have a little news flash.
Let's check the headlines.
No, it's real news for once.
The biggest stories of the local, regional, and national news.
This is huge news.
From UD Arena in Dayton, Ohio, is the 10 seeds battling first. Pardon me, the 16 seeds battling first last night with Wagner beating Howard 71-68. Instant classic to start off the 2024 NCAA tournament. And then the 10 seeds Colorado State boat racing Virginia 67-42. Somebody in the crowd last night in Dayton. And I'm glad that it's in Dayton. It's a Dayton, Ohio is a special place for hoops. And I'm glad that they have decided that they are going to hopefully keep that there for the remainder of NCAA tournament play, because you're not going to be able to get the same sort of atmosphere. Somebody had a sweater on last night that said, Virginia basketball is just Iowa football. And I thought to myself, man, that's a really good sweatshirt right there. Not a hoodie, just a regular sweatshirt. What do we call those? Are those crew neck sweatshirts? Is that what that's called if it doesn't have a hood?
I believe so.
I think that's what they are.
Yeah.
Doubleheader tonight over on True TV. Check your local listings. 16 seeds Grambling and Montana State at 6:40, and then at 9:10 Colorado against Boise State battling for 10 seeds. So really, really very interesting. And hopefully you guys enjoyed the Kevin Pauga conversation as much as I did, because I just want to nerd out sometimes. I will say this. You know I'm not a LeBron fan, and it's not that I don't respect his game. I think that he has taken some of the news stories and used those in such a way. I just feel like he's a liar. That's what I feel. So it's very difficult for me to separate the person who I feel it lies a lot, and then the player himself. However, his new podcast with JJ Redick is awesome. Yeah, that is something that will be on my list of things to do regularly, because just I love the theory. And what I thought was really interesting is someone, they were talking about baseline out of bounds, so blobs. Some people call them bobs. We call them slobs and blobs. Sideline out of bounds, baseline out of bounds, and how do you attack, and then how do you defend? And they were talking about baseline out of bounds defense, and someone had paired it up with what Michigan State had been doing, because a lot of people, you know, they think coverage is just a football term, but coverage is a basketball term. It's a defensive term, right? I mean, who are you covering? Who are you guarding? And so I think that, as you know, for anybody who is at the youth level coaching, that's really worth listening to. And you don't have to apply some sort of intricate Phil Jackson triangle offense where your guys are, you know, read and react But I do think that there is there are some principles there. Like, I don't believe that in youth basketball anybody should be able to play zone. And if you do play in a league that's a four-quarter league, maybe you can play zone for one quarter. Some people might not like that. But the problem is that when you just play zone on defense, what is happening, and this is league-wide, and I'd be willing to argue this with any league commissioner or whatever they call themselves, president, whatever it's called at the youth level. The reason it is one, when you play zone, you're not teaching good man-to-man fundamental concepts of defense. Because a man-to-man defense, those concepts will apply within the zone. And so man-to-man defense has got to be the priority across the board. And so if you're in a league that says some leagues, like the league that I used to coach in, it was inverse. It was you could play, you had to play man-to-man in the second quarter. Anything else was up for grabs, whatever you wanted to do. So everybody hid in a zone, and then the second quarter would just be a bloodbath because my team would just take other teams to the woodshed in those second quarters because no one could defend man-to-man. We played man-to-man the entire game. And the reason we did that is because of the concepts that are being taught. So I would encourage a youth coach to listen to these guys. Game theory is something that I love diving into. Like, why do you want to approach things or attack things a very specific way? What are you looking for? That's why, you know, when Coach Barlow and I go off on a tangent to talk about the most random stuff, I love that. I really do. That really, really gets me going. And hopefully, you know, you'll take some of the information and apply it to your youth league, right? And the other thing about zone at the youth level is that when you're playing zone on defense, you're forcing small kids to shoot a big ball that they probably shouldn't even be using to begin with, especially like the fifth grade level, to give them a women's ball. They should probably be using like a junior size ball, neither here nor there. But you're developing really bad habits from a shooting perspective because kids aren't strong enough. They're just not strong enough to get that big of a ball, right? And now with the Steph Curry revolution, everybody believes that they want to be a three-point specialist. It's just the whole thing is crazy. So for me, get in man-to-man, take pride in man-to-man defense, teach it well. If you don't know how to teach it, go to a coach's clinic. There's plenty of great clinics that are available on YouTube. And it's I wish I had more time because I am chomping at the bit to get back into coaching youth basketball. But there's just not enough time in the day. The Detroit Lions defensive end Romeo Okwara has decided to retire after 8 seasons. I think this is going to be more of a trend that we're going to see. Aaron Donald retiring after a decade. I don't think that Calvin and Barry are one-offs here. I think that you're going to see more and more of this. I think you'll see more guys at a decade or less call it quits in the NFL, you know, get out by the age of 30, 32, 33 years old with your mental and physical health relatively intact and move on with the rest of your life. You've made a ton of money. There's no reason to keep playing unless you absolutely love it. So I think that's a trend that will continue. Rams quarterback Jimmy Garoppolo said yesterday that his 2-game suspension for violating the NFL's performance-enhancing substance policy was because he messed up the therapeutic use exemption when he first got to Las Vegas. He'll sit out the first 2 games. Won't matter. He's not going to play anyways. Cleveland Browns signed newly acquired wide receiver Jerry Jeudy to a 3-year extension. The deal is worth $58 million, including $41 guaranteed. The Jets are adding ex-wide receiver from the L.A. Chargers, Mike Williams. Mike Will made it. A max contract value of $15 million for him. Chase Young is going to have a neck procedure, missed part of camp. I wonder how much of this was known ahead of him signing that 1-year deal worth $13 million when he visited the Saints. The Saints knew they were one of the teams aware of the neck issue and felt comfortable moving ahead. But I wonder if during the season that's why there wasn't a move made by, like, let's say, your Detroit Lions, for example. You know, how much of this, the medical with Davenport, they felt, you know, pretty good with the quad injury. And so it's always, you know, human capital, tough to work around. USA Basketball has had their draw for the upcoming Olympics. They'll get Serbia in their draw, South Sudan in their group as well, and then the qualifier from a tournament in Puerto Rico, you have Italy, Lithuania, and PR candidates to get the fourth and final spot there. That'll be July 7th in Puerto Rico's capital of San Juan. And then finally, the Detroit Red Wings winner chicken dinner, overtime winner, Lucas Raymond, not one but 2 goals in the game, one of which was on the power play, his 23rd, and then his 24th tied it up before Patrick Kane sealed the deal in overtime last night against the Columbus Blue Jackets. We'll step aside, back with more X's and Bros after this.
Huge here for the Michigan High School Athletic Association. You can stay up to date on the latest from Lansing 24/7 at MHSAA.com, at MHSAA on Twitter, and MHSAA on Facebook. The latest news, press releases, and stories connected to every high school in the state of Michigan, available for you 24/7 from the Michigan High School Athletic Association. Log on to MHSAA.com, at MHSAA on Twitter, and MHSAA on Facebook. And if you're looking for archive, boys and girls, high school sports, MHSAA.tv. That's MHSAA.tv. 24/7, everything you need to know about high school sports in Michigan. Log on to MHSAA.com.
Time out. The super sale is back at Meijer, Friday and Saturday only. Coca-Cola 2 liters are $1.49, Frank's Red Hot Sauce is $2.99, and Pace Salsa is just $1.49. Plus, get chicken wings, pre-made snack trays, and fresh and ready deli items to enjoy during the games. Meijer's Super Sale deals are in-store and online while supplies last. Shop this Friday and Saturday only during the Meijer Super Sale. Okay, game on. Exclusions apply. See all the deals in the Meijer app.
Van Andel Institute Purple Community is a grassroots fundraising network powered by the dedicated volunteers who support VAI's mission to improve human health now and in the future. When you raise funds through the Van Andel Institute Purple Community, 100% of the proceeds go directly to the Institute's research into diseases like cancer and Parkinson's, as well as VAI's science education programs. Learn how you can get involved at purplecommunity.org.
From Traverse City to the Glass City, GR to the Motor City, you're listening to X's and Bros on the Michigan Sports Network.
Welcome back here to X's and Bros, Michigan Sports Network. Great to have everybody riding along with us. I didn't mean to upset everybody with my Trey Burke is, or the Trey Burke block is the worst call in all of sports. Got a lot of Armando Galarraga tweets, and then the fact that I called that a random game in June really sent some people over a cliff. But what I did see yesterday floating around was Maxime. I'd have to imagine that his last name is pronounced Renault, who is a Frenchman from the city of Paris. So he is a Parisian. He is a junior who is 7 feet, 1 inches tall, 250 pounds, that averages nearly a double-double at 15 and a half points and 9.6 rebounds a game, along with two assists a game, shooting about 57% from the floor. This young fella has entered the transfer portal. Ryan, do you have Maxime Renault on the top of your shopping list? Are you going to, I don't know, s'il vous plaît, maybe parlez-vous français, to get Maxime Renault onto the Michigan State Spartan squad? Is this not what you are asking for? Is this not the big man that you want to hit the portal for? Somebody who has played some college ball, who knows what the hell is going on out there. He should have emphasis on should here, because I don't know what the exact, but based upon my simple math, entering the 21-22 season, will he have 1 year left of eligibility in a graduate year? Could you get him for 2 years? Could you get him on a one-year loan to be able to add somebody with experience? Now, the Pac-12 isn't exactly a dynamite league, but you can't teach height. 7'1", 250, a guy that knows how to play ball, come with that European experience. Is that not the shopping that you want to do? You want to add Maxime Renault to your cart there in East Lansing to get the Izzo kids up and running again? A big man that could play some ball. He's got to be target number one. I mean, I don't know what the NIL collective is at Michigan State, but I'm willing to throw some proverbial baggage at him immediately to get him to East Lansing. Immediately. And so that brings me to this question here. And I threw this out on the Twitterverse, and it's gotten a lot of reaction to it. And the question was actually very simple. Would you donate directly to your favorite team's NIL collective? Now, this doesn't mean I bought a shirt, I bought a hat. It doesn't mean I have some mittens or a bumper sticker. It means I'm writing a check. Even if you write checks anymore, I don't know. I'm giving them my credit card number or my debit card number, and I'm going to let them charge $500. Are you doing that? I put this out there. Almost 1,000 voters have hit the polls. They're hitting the polls early here in 2024. As an average Joe fan, are you donating any of your money to your favorite school's NIL collective? 14.2% of voters said yes. 86% said no. I find that fascinating. So Charlotte for UM said, I would be willing to bet that 83.6% at the time of my comment are the ones that scream the loudest about their favorite team's lack of successful NIL programs. Ty says, in a certain way, yes, I wouldn't straight up donate cash, but would / do buy merch or souvenirs that help fund the school's NIL. B says, tough ask for the average Joe to give up more of their income on top of purchasing clothing, tickets, concessions, and whatever comes along with being a, quote, normal fan. So confused why the fan should essentially be paying the players and not the universities that are making the money. That's the best comment there. Kate said, I wish I saw more of our student athletes not shoo away little kids after games who want a picture or an autograph because they care more about making money at NIL events to give out those. I saw plenty of four-year-olds crying because they were told no. There needs to be balance. Okay, so I want to talk about that. If it's after a win and a player wants to hang around a little bit afterwards and sign some stuff or take some photos, some selfies afterwards, that's fine. The people gathering outside of the stadium near where players are loading onto their bus to get a selfie or a picture is weird to me. That's kind of strange behavior. I'll never understand it. They're just getting on the bus. Maybe it's because I'm jaded from being around it, but they're just human beings. They're just like you and I. Put their pants on the same way. They happen to be really good and practice really hard and put in a lot of effort at their craft. Their craft happens to be very, very important to American society. It's no different than an English footballer, right? Or a Serbian basketball player. We have all, like, professional athletes / celebrities. They're just people, man. They're just people. They're not Superman. They're not heroes. Like, they're just people. Some use their powers, if you will, for good. Some don't really care. And to be honest with you, don't really have a responsibility. Their responsibility to you is to be the best football player they can be. That's the only responsibility they have. Anything else that they do extra is totally fine. I don't believe that plenty of four-year-olds crying because they were told no. Well, maybe those four-year-olds should get told no more often and they wouldn't cry about it. There's one. Number two, shoo away little kids after games because they care about making money at NIL events to give out those. They should care about the NIL events. And to be honest with you, if every player said, no, I have an autograph signing, I can't sign anything, but I do have a signing coming up at, you know, Somerset Collection, you know, next month. Cool. Respect it. They don't owe you anything. They just got done playing. They don't owe you a thing. This idea that, like, you know, for players to stop by, that's, you know, that's fine. That's great. They stop by, they say hi, if you want to take a selfie, whatever the case may be. Some guys, especially if it's pregame, don't want to be bothered. You have to respect that space. Nobody's bothering you on your way to work. Some guys postgame, especially after a loss, they're not taking it very well. They probably don't want to hear, see, or do anything. They want to get on the bus and get the hell out of there as quickly as possible. You know, the last thing they want to do is be harassed in the parking lot. So I'm kind of, you know, that one there, I don't know if we saw little kids crying. I who knows? Austin says, Austin Bowman, avid listener to the program. I'm just trying to survive in this economy. Trav, allow me to feed my kids before feeding someone else's first. Joel Feldman, PhD, said, I wish I could, but I'm broke. I'm busted. No bread. Hubs, no, between parking and the tickets themselves, my university is big enough to shell out their own money for NIL deals. LWAR 13, this is one that has frustrated me regarding Michigan fans. So much cheap talk about the money cannon, but what most mean is someone else's money. Yes, we have many affluent alums and fans, but that illusion that Michigan money is overflowing is insane. Danny in Brighton said, sooner or later, you're going to have donor fatigue. That's what we talked a little bit about yesterday with the donor fatigue. Damn, the people voting yes must have a big bank account, according to Jay Filla. Money they don't know what to do with kind of money. Yeah, I could see that. El Five Toe Dentista. He said, the results of this poll confirm my belief that people are idiots. And I said, can you expand on your response? People want their team to be competitive. They complain about the AD, the coach, the recruits deciding to follow the money when all things otherwise may be equal. Not everyone needs to give $1,000 to Champion Circle, but throwing the cost of a new sweatshirt to the fund or a t-shirt multiplied out by 100,000 people could certainly go a long way to changing a team's buying options in the portal. Everyone has an opportunity to be a part of the solution rather than complain about the problem, just like voting in a democracy. Will Skunkle then, God bless him, down in Houston, says, so is this the new, if you don't vote, you can't complain? If you don't pay into your school's NIL, then shut up. God bless him. That's just Will. William off the top rope. I am fascinated by this question of what people are willing to do to, you know, quote unquote, get their team in the right position. You know, and for the average Joe to not only buy tickets, you know, and some people don't understand how the NIL works. Like, they don't understand that the school can't be directly involved with the NIL. But it's just like anything else, right? The school can't be involved with it, and it's expensive to turn that stadium on anywhere you go. I know a lot of Lions fans were like, oh, I can't believe that prices went up. In some cases, 80% price increase for my season tickets. This is price gouging. No, you didn't have really any fluctuation on the price of tickets. I didn't realize we're over. We're going to come right back and talk about that.
Bill Simonson here for my good friend Josh Garvey. Now, he's a managing shareholder at Dorn Mayhew's Grand Rapids office. Their world headquarters are in Troy, Michigan, on the east side of the state, and they have locations all around the world. They have over 550 motivated accounting professionals, 90 years in business, and I mentioned the 10 offices worldwide. So if you want to connect and partner with one of the top CPA accounting and business firms in the world, they're right here in Michigan. Dorn Mayhew's Troy office on the east side of the state, and Josh Garvey is a managing shareholder for their Dorn Mayhew GR office. Right there by the S-curve, you'll see the new Dorn Mayhew sign. You can find out more. Just Google Dorn Mayhew. That's DoreNMayhew or Dorn.com. They're one of America's and the world's top CPA accounting and business firms. They're Dorn Mayhew.
If you or your family is touched by autism, learn more about Freddy's Foundation at hashtag pop the tab at freddythepizzaman.com. That's F-R-E-D-I, thepizzaman.com. Or email freddythepizzaman at gmail.com.
Can't call in? Text us using the keyword sports radio and send it to 21000 or tweet us at XB Mornings. Now, back to X's and Bros with Anthony Bellino here on the Michigan Sports Network.
Welcome back here to X's and Bros, Michigan Sports Network. Great to have you ride along with us. Ryan is on hold. Want to get to Ryan right away. Love that song choice there. New York State of Mind. A little Nas for us this morning. Ryan, do you have Maxime Renaud, as I assume that's how you'd pronounce the Parisian's name? Do you have him on your shopping list?
Of course. It's like you want to put four of them in your shopping cart. But it's back in like COVID times. Like, sorry, one per customer if he's available.
Oh, man. So it's like toilet paper. No, it totally makes sense.
Yep.
But it's got to be, and you have to imagine, this is such a weird time. I don't know about you, but I really disagree with how we have changed the signing day time periods. I really disagree with how we've changed the portal time periods. I know that Tom Crean said, you know, you got plenty of time to recruit the portal. It, like, you really don't, though, because if somebody offers a kid something, he wants to sign right away, you might have missed out on an opportunity. So Maxime Renaud enters his name into the portal, along with everybody from Michigan basketball. Not like, I mean, they won eight games, so I can't imagine those guys are going to be high up on anybody's shopping list, but neither here nor there. They have to do it, right? It just makes personal sense for them. That was just a unnecessary shot at the team right there. But when you think about it, like, Tom Izzo and company are trying to get ready for an NCAA tournament game, along with all these other coaches, not named Tony Bennett. But, like, at this point, we got to do something about the calendar. Like, we have to. There's no way we can continue to function like this.
Right. I think it's baseball that really kind of does it right, where it's just the NFL, I think they take too long with their supposed offseason and then legal tampering periods. Baseball is just like, hey, when the World Series is over, go ahead, do what you want. Like, when the season is officially over, go for it. You want to make trades? Cool. You want to sign people? Great. Like, you want to do this? Great. Like, college basketball and football need to do the same. Like, when your season's officially over, go into the portal, start getting kids. Signing day, we can give you a couple weeks right after the season ends, whatever, so that way it's like, just let the people that are actually still playing, like, focus on the actual sport.
Yeah, I like that a lot. You know, I like that a lot. I would say the day after the national championship in football, the day after the NCAA tournament run.
You could go 30 minutes after the game's over. Like, hey, when we're off air, that's when you can go into the portal and start announcing stuff.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. We're closing out our coverage here on CBS, but coming up next, Portal Combat. And all the kids, like, you know, they get all the screens just like they used to on signing day, and they all file their paperwork and fax it into the portal office. It's ridiculous. Just ridiculous.
I mean, it would help, you know, 99% of the teams. Yeah, it'd kind of stink if you're some of the final two, but at that moment, it's just like, okay, like, we also can have the cachet of just coming in last minute. And in football, you get a month anyway, or you used to, a month between, you know, the conference championship and the championship game, where you could actually do some light recruiting during that time. But yeah, it's just the calendar's all messed up, and the NCAA doesn't care because they don't have to care.
Yeah, just one of those things that, you know, really, honestly, they could do something proactive here that would just, it would honestly just make too much sense. Here's a fun fact for you. Did you know Virginia has six NCAA tournament wins since 2018, and all six came in the 2019 title run? They have not won an NCAA tournament game in any other tournament in the last 7 years otherwise. And then got bounced
right, because
last night.
Before that, they lost to UMBC. In the tournament before that, they lost to Florida in the second round, where they scored, a whopping, like, under 40 points. And, yeah, lost to Barlow's buddies in, what, 21? Yeah, and like I said this on Monday when everyone wanted to call in, complain about Michigan State online, and what I said, don't look at the Spartans. Look at Virginia.
You did say that. And now look at Virginia. Now look what happened. Look what they've done. Look what they have done. And it's
even worse. It's just, there were, I can't even count. It's on your screen now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 teams with higher net rankings left out of the NCAA tournament. Indiana State, St. John's, Pittsburgh, Villanova, Wake Forest, Oklahoma, Utah, and Ohio State.
Had Jay Wright still been at Villanova, I bet you they get in.
I don't think, not with their resume. They were not good.
But with the higher net ranking than Virginia?
That's why people were complaining. Even Joe Lunardi was complaining. So he's like, oh, you left out Indiana State. And then people were fact-checking him. And they're like, you had Virginia ahead of Indiana State in your little bracketology there, buddy.
Pal.
So.
Sport. And that, Chief, the ACC, right? And this kind of goes back into, you know, what I was talking about before we hit the break. So we'll just kind of flip-flop segments here. When Greg Sankey's talking about adding more teams and expanding the tournament, right, he's looking at the dollar sign, and this is what they're looking to add, right? They're looking to add more teams like Virginia, a mediocre team out of an ACC that, let's face it, they were pretty mediocre all year long. You have Duke and UNC up at the top in just a very top-heavy conference. The Big Ten, which is, you know, over the last few years has been historically strong. And, you know, they weren't very good this year. I don't really even know how else to necessarily say.
That's what everyone does the day after the bracket comes out. They want to yell about bubble teams, and it's like, let my mediocre team in over your mediocre team.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, we're just all arguing about teams that are like, like, they're okay. Like, yeah, there's instances of Syracuse and UCLA making big runs as first four teams, but it's okay. Like, but what are we really doing? Like, look at the percentages of teams that make the Final Four of the championship game that are seed, like, 1 through 4. Like, why are we really arguing this?
Yeah, it's the And I want to be kind of clear here that I don't want to just, you know, bang on Virginia today, because although I don't like what Greg Sankey is saying, because
they
deserve it, but I'm not going to use them as
anecdotal evidence that it deserves a little bit of a lashing. Yes, it's not the end all be all evidence to say, like, this is why we can't do this. But the committee deserves to have their nose rubbed in this. Like, smacked with a newspaper and say, you did this.
Somebody had said, I hope Greg Sankey is watching this Virginia game on Twitter last night. The only thing about it is that I know what my argument is against Greg Sankey, and it's not because of this one individual game, right? I'm not going to use the one individual game to counter with, like, oh, Greg Sankey, look at what Virginia did this year, hardy har har, this is why you can't, right? It's not necessarily, I'm not using Virginia. What I'm doing is I'm looking at it because I know that they're not going to open up opportunities for the rest of college sports. The opportunity is going to go to the haves and to the have-nots, and I don't mean to sound communist right now, but you know, unless they were going to change something with the regular season champions and conferences, and, you know, maybe 353 teams or whatever it is, it's watered down. Maybe there are, you know, 200 more teams than necessary. You know, maybe you have to sponsor football to be available for basketball. Maybe there's a little joint kind of play here. But then that takes away so much of what the Cinderella story is, which is why so many people watch this tournament.
Classic basketball programs, like, you're taking away Villanova.
Mm-hmm.
And Villanova,
Xavier.
I'm sorry, but Villanova has been a staple in college basketball for over 40 years. Look at the work Creighton has done over the last 25 years. Xavier's done over the last 25
Marquette.
Years. Marquette, like some of these schools are able to support basketball because it's 15 players that they're responsible for financing, not 80. And so they made a financial, logical decision. You know, we could put our money into this. As a university, we can finance this and be Division I. Because Villanova, they have Division II football.
Right.
I don't know what Creighton and
Brian Westbrook. The best Villanova running back of all time, Brian Westbrook. And I say that just because it's like, you start to kick out all these ideas of how you might be able to change, how we might be able to better the system. And then we could take a step back from all of it, right? As you point out, some of the programs, and we're sitting here going back and forth of teams that are, teams that are more than capable on just the basketball side, that don't need a football team to play D1 hoops, right? And maybe the point of this argument is maybe it doesn't necessarily need to change. Maybe we could just keep it as is. I'm not even a real big fan of the first four. It's like a mini tournament to even get into the tournament. But regardless, they've expanded it. They've added four more games, two more nights of television, which gives you all that much more inventory for your sales staff to be able to go out and sell and do the TV thing, right? Make the TV magic happen, which is great.
It's
That's cool.
The only change that the first four needs to make, and I'll take it from a different sport, because wrestling has matches like this for all, like pretty much every tournament you can think of for, districts, regional, state championships. You'll see in the national championships, they're called rat tail matches. Instead of first four, because it's like a little rat tail off the bracket where you're kind of wrestling in. But instead of doing it like 2 days before, giving team rest, schedule, like, so if Wagner has to go play UNC. Wagner and Howard, they play at 12 o'clock Thursday. You know what their next game should be? Either Thursday night or Friday. Like, Fair. Hey, you're going right back in. We're not giving you 2 days rest to regroup, get the momentum. Like, you're going right back in, because that's how wrestling works. The rat tail matches are the first match of the day, reset, then they're the last matches of the first round of the wrestling tournament.
Well, that makes sense. And Carl K3 tweets in, so who are you guys saying should have been in, and how was the committee supposed to come to that conclusion? That's what we all want to know. Right, for all of the fringe teams that were around, a team like Kansas State, for example, was their resume good enough to get them in because of how good the Big 12 was this year? The Big 12, they have eight teams in? They have eight teams, the Big 12? Big 12 and SEC with eight apiece? Left my paperwork
in there.
Yeah, I left my paperwork in the other office over there. I'll grab it for the third hour. The, it's a... So maybe you make a decision for Kansas State, but this is the annual argument that's made about who got left out, who's in, who's not in. My team deserves to be in. My team shouldn't be in. And they're never going to, as long as you have committees deciding things, they're never going to be perfect because there isn't a balanced schedule. So I'm okay. As long as we know, and Tom had said this on Mad Dog, right? He just wanted to know exactly what the criteria is going to be. Are we going to go based on the net? Is there something else? And I thought that the conversation with Kevin Pauga, where he's talking about, the net is basically a sorting tool, is what it is. And okay, all right, so it's a sorting tool that you're placing all these teams in based on their quadrant of victories. But what else are we? Are we looking at Bart Torvik? Are we looking at Ken Pom? Are we looking at the KPI? How are we measuring the metrics, right? All the data that we get. And then how do we balance this out? I'm not really mad at the field here. I'm not. My biggest gripe is this idea that we want to expand on the tournament. So what? So that like an Ohio State can get in? And it's not anything personal against Ohio State. It's just one of the teams that popped up on the top of my mind because they were being shown on the NIT and some highlights on TV. And it's like, is that what we want? We want an Ohio State team to get in who had a little fire at the end of the year, but hadn't won a road game in over a calendar year. That's what we're looking for. So I think that from that regard, in that perspective, the tournament doesn't need to expand any further than where it's at. And I, for college football, I've always been a fan of expansion, specifically because of the lower the lowest percentage of teams to make a playoff that was not determined by anything else other than a committee that sat in a room and this year once again told you that an undefeated conference champion did not get in. It's better that they didn't get in for Michigan's purposes, because had Florida State gotten in and gone to the Rose Bowl with Michigan and Michigan beats Florida State and they didn't have their starting quarterback, they wouldn't have to listen to all that. Right, but we beat Alabama, and once we beat Alabama in the Rose Bowl, that was it. You knew we were beating Washington, and that was going to be, you know, we were going to win a national championship, and that was going to be that. But when you have 133 teams allegedly competing for a national championship, you know, you had to expand the playoff to more than just four, right? Because those four teams in the beginning of each year, you could comfortably bet Alabama, Georgia, Ohio State, right? You could throw out a couple, maybe a Clemson. You could throw out some team names there and comfortably bet that the committee was going to go in that direction. And that's why I've wanted expansion in college football. I've also wanted criteria. And to be honest with you, the criteria in basketball is simple. Win your conference tournament. NC State probably doesn't get into the NCAA tournament unless they win the ACC tournament. And that's exactly what they did. They caught fire. They won it all. It's great for them. On the opposite end, it's heartbreaking for Indiana State. We would much rather see Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Larry Blurd. We'd rather see that guy, whatever his real name is, than NC State, right? But this is where we find ourselves.
That's his name. He's an Avila.
So we know Freddie loves him. Right off the rip, we know Freddie loves him. Is it Robbie?
Yeah, Robbie Avila.
Robbie Avila, God bless him. So that's where I'm at with the NCAA tournament. It's great entertainment. I'm all about it. It's fun. It's exciting. And I don't think, I thought that the Big East statement that they threw out about how, like, hey, look, you know, UConn being a number one, Marquette being right there, you know, we got three teams right at the top. Like, this is great. We're happy about that. Are we disappointed because of how strong our league is that we didn't get more teams in? Sure. But that's, we've gotten to a point now where, you know, as long as everybody's not going to sue immediately because we didn't get in, right, then I'm fine, right? I understand FSU and Clemson's gripe right now with the ACC because that conference doesn't get any respect. And if you look at the new ESPN deal for the college football playoff, average of $1.3 billion per year, specifically for the playoff, not the regular season, and the payout structure of where the Big Ten is at in the SEC, they're tied with the highest percentage of revenue, and then it drops conference for conference. Like the ACC and the Big 12 are literally told on a sheet of paper, data, numbers right in front of you, you are going to get paid less because you're not as good. That, to me, is wild, but that's the evolution of the sports world that we are in. We'll step aside. Hour number three coming at you next year, X's and Bros, Michigan Sports Network.
Time out. The super sale is back at Meijer, Friday and Saturday only. Coca-Cola 2 liters are $1.49. Frank's Red Hot Sauce is $2.99. And Pace Salsa is just $1.49. Plus, get chicken wings, pre-made snack trays, and fresh and ready deli items to enjoy during the games. Meijer's super sale deals are in-store and online while supplies last. Shop this Friday and Saturday only during the Meijer super sale. Okay, game on. Exclusions apply. See all the deals in the Meijer app.
Huge here for my good friend Drew and the crew at Impact Power Sports. Now, they're located on 14 Mile Road in Rockford, just north of Grand Rapids here on the west side of the state. They are Michigan's newest Yamaha go-to golf cart dealer. Now, if you're looking for a golf cart for the neighborhood, the business, the golf club, maybe that second home or the lake, stop by and see Drew and the crew. They can hook you up today at Impact Power Sports. They also have e-bikes, quads, side-by-side, yard toys for the big boys and the big girls. Anything you need when it comes to power, they have it at Impact Power Sports on 14 Mile Road in Rockford. Also, if you want a shot at winning Lomas Brown's Lions golf cart, a custom-built Lions golf cart, text IMPACT
to 21000. That's Impact to 21000. And you could win Lomas Brown's Lions golf cart this summer from Impact Power Sports and The Huge Show.
There's a new player in town. Hi, I'm Herman Moore, Lions All-Pro wide receiver, and I'm talking about Eagle Casino and Sports, the real money mobile casino. It's so easy to play. You can go from wager to winner to wallet, just like that.
Sign up now and we'll match your deposit up to $1,500. Or you can get a risk-free bet up to $1,000.
Eagle Casino and Sports, made in Michigan, made for Michigan.
Must be 21 or older in Michigan to play.
Roast Umber is a farm direct coffee sourced from Central American farmers and roasted in Grand Rapids. And also the Nitro cold brew coffee is a convenient and healthy option for energy with no sugar additives. Look for it at your local retailer or at roastumber.com.
The Freddie the Pizza Man Foundation is dedicated to providing support to families and Michigan schools touched by autism. We invite you to join us in supporting these families and schools by making a donation at FreddieThePizzaMan.com. With your donation, you can help provide essential resources that can make a real impact. Visit FreddieThePizzaMan.com to make a donation and to learn more about the foundation's mission. That's FreddieThePizzaMan.com. Together, we can make a difference.
Huge here. AB's doing a heck of a job, and I'm ready to drop some huge opinions about what he's talking about later today at 3 on the Michigan Sports Network.
It's time for Michigan Sports Talk Morning Show, broadcasting live all across the state of Michigan and Northwest Ohio. This is X's and Bros.
It out to Sadiq Bey.
Defended in the corner. To Abdul Rahman at midcourt. Extra pass. And it goes for the win. The three-pointer by Jordan Poole. Here's the give. Walker. Derek Walker. That's down. Smarty.
Goff's got it. Back. Looks. Throws. Ends up.
Yes. Caught. Tucks down to Kurt Myers. They did it. Amon Ra St. Brown to the receiving end.
Sends one to deep left center field. Back it goes, and that ball's
out of here. A grand slam from Miguel Cabrera. He's got two goals. Larkin in on goal. Scores! His first career hat trick in his seventh season for Dylan Larkin.
Here's your host, Anthony Bellino.
Rise and shine, folks. Welcome back here. X's and Bros on the Michigan Sports Network. So great to have you riding along with us. Sam and Sagnasty says, my dream scenario this year in the tournament is seeing Longwood take on Moorhead in the Natty. The competition will be stiff. I think Moorhead will get their happy ending. You know, really, Sam and Sagnasty, you might appreciate that. In every tournament since 2021, a top two seed has lost in the first round to a team with a euphemistic name. I'll go that route. In 2021, we had Oral Roberts defeating Ohio State. In 2022, we had St. Peter's defeating Kentucky. In 2023, we had Fairleigh Dickinson defeating Purdue. This year, you have Houston versus Longwood. So just for those that have a sick sense of humor and want to be childish this morning, we welcome you to the program. Let's get to Freddie, who's on hold right now. You can join us, too, 866-838-4843. Good morning, Freddie.
Man, it's a child show. Jeez, act like a child, why don't you? Lordy.
Family-friendly.
Hey, who's a team that beat Michigan State earlier in the – it was a 16 that beat Michigan State a couple years ago. Middle Tennessee State?
Yeah, it was a 15-2 matchup.
Oh, sorry to hear that. I thought that was funny. Hey, I haven't heard from Dave from Hudsonville. Dave, your team is in a tournament. I haven't heard from you. What's going on? Are you a little worried?
They're worried. They're nervous. They're nervous. They're hiding out right now. Go Mississippi State. You got Chris Jans. Are you serious? Super scintillating, sensational, baby.
So before I get to the Red Wings, I heard you guys you guys mocking me about Avila. Listen, I won't even bring up Avila's name. I'll just say this. Okay, I'll give you four names. Okay, I'm only gonna give you four. That's it.
Larry Blurred.
Jackson Joel, Colt Keith, Chase Young, and
Spencer Torkelson.
Don't put words into my mouth like you always do. I even bring up Spencer Torkelson. No. Because those guys were top five picks, so I just want to make sure that, you know, any GM can pick a first round pick. Oh yeah. No, I gave you four names, and I just want you guys to go to bed every night, put your head in your pillow, and say, you know what? It's okay to give praise to people.
I love Alavila.
No. Yeah, listen.
The cupboards are full. I know. He did his job. He's the best ever.
Everyone said Jim Harbaugh got the cupboards empty. No, he didn't. So, now, Alavila left the cupboards really full, and that's all I'm going to say, and I am done. So, mock all you want. Now, you got a listener that likes Xavier, right? What's his name?
Doug?
I forgot his name. Doug. Yeah, I turned on the TV yesterday. I said, you know what? I'm going to watch a little bit of this game. Georgia Xavier. Man, Georgia was stomping them by 20 points. Then I look up, I'm like, they're in the NIT? Click. I turned it off. I'm like, what is going on? Xavier, I picked you to win it all this year. And you're in the NIT, getting stopped by Georgia. I mean, was Stetson Bennett on the basketball team? What was going on?
They needed more of the Blue Blob and D'Artagnan out there.
Yeah, it almost looked like Georgia was playing Michigan in a bowl game. I'll tell you, that was pretty bad. Anyways, now, oh, if you don't mind me saying, too, before I get to the Red Wings, you know, when Jeff Blasio got fired, Matt Patricia got fired, Jim Schwartz got fired, I'm just naming some coaches that got fired in this town. You know, I thought, why didn't the team post a picture of them on X the way Michigan did Juwan Howard? Juwan Howard got blown out. It caused nothing but drama for 3 years. And they posted a picture of him, Michigan legend. I mean,
it's just a thank you note. That's all it is. Just thank you for your service. It's no different. Well, a guy won Coach of the Year. Guy made a Sweet 16. Guy won an Elite Eight. Guy won the Big Ten. Like, it's not, mind you, it was all Beeline's guys. But it's not like he didn't have any success whatsoever. But you're allowed to say thank you. Like, it's fine. All the colleges do that. Oh, most of them do.
I'm gonna look back and see if they said thank you to Jeff Blasio when they threw him to the curb. I mean, only Michigan would do something like that. I mean,
that's not true. You know, you and your anti-Michigan hate. You know, I'm just sitting here with not one but two national championships in my lifetime. Your college team hasn't won squat ever in anything. I get to live with two of them, and I saw two playoff wins in the same month. I had the best football month ever. Yeah, I'm like MC Hammer, can't touch this.
One and a half. So the Red Wings, man, I tell you, Anthony.
Oh, it was bad last night. That, it was close.
I'm telling you, man. I tweeted it out. I mean, you don't pay attention to my Twitter anymore, but I tweeted it out that. Man, that game was 25 seconds from heads rolling. I'm telling you, it was going to be either very bleak, or now that could be something that really sparked this team. Patrick Kane has been absolutely incredible for this team. He has been incredible for the players around him. That's what superstars do, whether he's a superstar or not any longer. He was a superstar. He's really good. He elevates that team so much the way Kenny Rogers did when they signed him. It pushed Verlander to two, where he belonged at that time, and elevated the rest of the team. Patrick Kane has absolutely been incredible. He is basically the side. It's basically what Kenny Rogers brought the 2006 Detroit Tigers. It's been that incredible. He has been
a godsend. There is no doubt about that. I mean, when Stevie Y said, you know, we're expecting him to be the player he was 2 years ago and not the player he was last year, they take a flyer on him. DeBrincat, in the helping of recruiting him here to Detroit, is great. But I think that, you know, and I'm not – this isn't a bad thing at all. Patrick Kane deserves all the praise in the world. DeBrincat's been great. Larkin's been great. But what's lost in this is we have a budding superstar on this team. And that's Lucas Raymond. Lucas Raymond is having a campaign right now where he is proving, like, whatever his next deal is going to be, they're going to max him out. Because that kid can play hockey. Oh, my God.
And how much has Patrick Kane helped that kid? I think he's helped him tremendously. See, the reason why I say superstars, Patrick Kane, his goal yesterday, the one in Chicago, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm sure I'm missing one. Those are huge goals.
Clutch.
It's like when I used to watch Yzerman back in the late 80s, early 90s. When Yzerman wasn't playing, that team was absolutely hogwash. When he's on the ice, completely different team. Because Yzerman was an absolute superstar. So, yes, guys get cute goals and they're good. But when you get those clutch goals, it just elevates a team. Some guys are leaders and some guys are followers. And that's just, it's that way in life. It's that way in sports. That guy's a leader. And that might have been Yzerman's best pickup in his 5 years here. There's no doubt about it. That's his not draft pick, his absolute best pickup, man.
We got to get Patrick Kane a pizza. We got to send him into Freddy's to get a Patrick Kane pie. We get to design his own specialty pie. Well, we'll be back with more X's and Bros after this year on the Michigan Sports Network.
It's time to go on the court with Anthony Bellino.
It's a new day to celebrate and be free. It's a new day full of action and excitement because it's a new day for winning only at Soaring Eagle Casino and Resort. It's a new day. Visit SoaringEagleCasino.com. And so that officially does it for the 2023-24 Michigan basketball season. A one and done in the Big Ten tournament as the Wolverines fell to the Penn State Nittany Lions 66-57. Not only did the Maize and Blue lose the game, but on Friday they also lost their coach as well, with Juwan Howard being relieved of his duties in Ann Arbor. His time started fast. He led Michigan to an Elite Eight, where a three-point attempt from Franz Wagner late in the game against UCLA nearly sent the Wolverines to a Final Four. A year later, they win the Sweet 16. He even had an AP Coach of the Year award. But trouble followed the program, and as Beeline's guys left, so did the wins. On and off the court issues, like the slap of a Wisconsin staffer, a heated argument with Maryland's head coach Mark Turgeon, where he said that he would kill him, and a kerfluffle with the program's former strength coach John Sanderson, has all led to this moment right now, where Michigan is now looking for their next head coach.
Huge here for Van Andel Institute Purple Community. Now, they're a grassroots fundraising network powered by the volunteers who support VAI's mission to improve health now and in the future. Learn more at purplecommunity.org.
Time out. The super sale is back at Meijer, Friday and Saturday only. Coca-Cola 2 liters are $1.49, Frank's Red Hot Sauce is $2.99, and Pace Salsa is just $1.49. Plus, get chicken wings, pre-made snack trays, and fresh and ready deli items to enjoy during the games. Meijer's Super Sale deals are in-store and online while supplies last. Shop this Friday and Saturday only during the Meijer Super Sale. Okay, game on. Exclusions apply. See all the deals in the Meijer app.
Huge here. AB's doing a heck of a job, and I'm ready to drop some huge opinions about what he's talking about later today at 3 on the Michigan Sports Network.
You're listening to Michigan Statewide Morning Show, X's and Bros, right here on the Michigan Sports Network.
Welcome back here to X's and Bros, Michigan Sports Network. Great to have you ride along with us, no matter who you are, where you are, how you may be listening, all across the great state of Michigan and in Northwest Ohio and worldwide on the iHeartRadio app. So great to have you riding along with us. You can call us 866-838-4843, 866-838-4843, 866-838-4843. Doug E. Fresh and the Blue Blob calling in. Good morning, Doug. How are you?
Good morning. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm great. I was good, and I'm sitting here just enjoying my morning coffee. And
just catching strays.
Yeah. It's just phenomenal on so many levels. I mean, let's break it down. So one, it's the NIT. No one cares, including the teams playing. Two, he's talking about a game where he should have looked up, because Xavier actually came back from 24 points down. Of course, they lost, though, which is the story of their season. And for most of us, if you have a team that performed 16 and 18 over the course of the season, you kind of, you know, chalked it up to, well, let's just focus on next year a while ago. But yeah, Freddie doesn't need to talk about really any of our sports teams, because he just consistently just doesn't have all the information and just, you know, spews things without really having any kind of things to go along with them to make any real good argument. So I just had to call in and just say, I feel like Allen Iverson. Like, what are we talking about? Are we talking about the tournament? No. We're talking about the NIT?
Hey,
not the tournament.
Look, you know, the AI, you know, he missed practice so he could attend his best friend's funeral. That quote is often misrepresented. For those that don't know, that is the background of why he missed practice and why they were questioning him about missing practice. But I do want to say this, Doug.
Yeah.
What on God's green earth are we going to do in the Mid-American Conference?
Oh, gosh. I mean, we all have good ideas. Now, whether or not the people in charge will make the needed adjustments, because someone said the other day, and I think many of us have said, they at the very least they should adopt what the West Coast Conference is doing, and you know, crazy idea, actually try to help your best teams make the tournament. Now, I will say Akron was a very close second, so at least, you know, one of the two best teams went, but that certainly doesn't help my Rockets, who it's on them, right? That they got to do what's needed to be done to make the tournament, but they have not made the tournament since 1980. So it's basketball is just half the story. You know, football is just not really fun to be a fan with Maction. Everyone likes to talk about Maction, I think, besides anyone that actually roots for a Mac team. And it's just tough.
Wow. I mean, the Mountain West did it. They got six teams in.
Yeah.
And I feel like the Mountain West is comparable to the Mid-American Conference from a revenue standpoint. I feel like they're comp, and I don't know those numbers off the top of my head, but they've always seemed very similar. Football's always been very, very even. You know, I just, for me, speaking freely here, I am just so sick and tired of, like, all of the, you know, all the, like, just, you got to get to the tournament, right? And the league as a whole, like, to be a one-bid league right now and be in the Mid-American Conference, be in that middle group where, you know, we've looked at the KenPom rankings, we've looked at the RPI just literally fall off of a cliff. Like, at some point, you got to go on the road, you got to beat people, right? You got to schedule tough, yeah. and you have to go beat people. You have to. Like, there's no, like, oh, we scheduled whoever, like, okay, and you lost by 30.
Yeah, there's going to be two sides of it. Now, you mentioned earlier the Big East and their statement on the three teams, but I just looking at some of the different, like, various people, directors of basketball and whatnot, with their guarded comments on it so far, quite frankly, and this is going to create the divide even more, the teams in the bigger conferences, they're no longer incentivized to play a tough non-conference. I mean, Xavier finished the year 16 and 18. They were 0-9 against They played a really hard schedule. They were 0-9 against UConn, lost them three times. Purdue lost to Houston, lost to Marquette twice, lost to Creighton twice. And so why do they need to go and play those tough games when they're won? I mean, obviously they're in a different ballpark. They should have won the games the other games, right? In the 16-8, they were against everybody else. They had their chances and they missed it. But that said, if you look at the tough schedule that the non-conference schedule that many of the teams play, it's just not, they're not being benefited for it, right? They're not getting the credit when it comes to tournament consideration. And then the other side of it, to your point, the teams like the Mountain West, like the MAC, you remember back in the day, Missouri Valley, they used to
play
that RPI game perfectly. And now there's different metrics, right? And so you just got to figure out how to get those numbers right. And then also it doesn't help. And someone made this point with Georgetown and DePaul being so bad. And, you know, you look at ACC Louisville being so bad, that doesn't help, right? You can't have the bottom be so far at the bottom. But for these teams like the MAC and the Mountain West, you gotta find the right mix to get those numbers up. And that's the crazy part, is you got to game it to try to make sure those metrics wear out. And you do have to have something in the non-conference. So it's funny. I was just about to just rip on Gonzaga and say, man, they shouldn't have made it. They had an okay season. They were there for their standards. They were pretty mediocre in the West Coast Conference. But they did beat Kentucky on the road. That's a heck of a win, right? And so you got to be able to kind of claim those big victories and really just make hay in your conference.
Hey, here's something for you. So you had Drake, who was 28-6 out of the Missouri Valley, who you just mentioned. Indiana State, 29th. Drake, 47th. Bradley, 59th. The Missouri Valley had three teams inside the NCAA net top 60. You look at San Diego State on the Mountain West. They got six teams into the tournament this year. They lost to BYU. They beat Long Beach State, who beat Michigan. They beat St. Mary's. They beat Washington. They beat Cal. You're never going to get a MAC team that's going to be able to pull off a run like that. Never. Like, they're like, you know, I just I get frustrated when I hear, like, this has never been done, that's never been done. Well, what does it matter? Like, we don't have a single team inside the KenPom top 100. We might get one KenPom top 100 win in the conference each year. Like, being the best of the worst conference, like, what? Like, it's so frustrating, man. And it's a conference-wide problem. It's, like, conference-wide. Like, stop scheduling these, you know, non-D1 teams. You got to get rid of that. You got to go on the road. Like, I don't know. But you have to play so many home games, and you can't get anybody to come play at home. So does the MAC need a MAC, like, Missouri Valley, like, challenge? I don't know, because why would the Missouri Valley take this at that point?
It would have to be, like you said, you got to keep those lower, you know, quad three, quad four games away as much as you can.
We are quad four.
They are.
We are. Our whole conference is quadrant three, quadrant four.
They got to raise everyone up, right? And it's really not a matter of what do you mean? Is that we got to, you know, have all these world beater teams? It's not that. You just have to be just in the lower bracket of quality, right? Like schedule quality teams and all that. And the people that do all the scheduling, I'm sure they know, you know, what the right mix needs to be now. Now, why aren't they doing it? So that's something that, I mean, I think it was you or somebody else said the other day, like, ever since the priority went to football, basketball has just fallen by the wayside. We've been talking about it back in late 90s, early 2000s. MAC basketball was fantastic. There was, you know, NBA player, three or four NBA players coming out of there every couple of years. And you just don't have it now.
Hey, for the record, the best team in the MAC this year, Akron, by KenPom ranking and by net ranking, they were in quad three and quad four, 20-4. They played 24 total games in the bottom two quadrants. We're never going to be able to get out of that. We got to step aside, Doug. Appreciate you. Love you, man. Thanks for the phone call. We'll be back with more X's and Bros after this.
Bill Simonson here for my good friend Josh Garvey. Now, he's a managing shareholder at Dorn Mayhew's Grand Rapids office. Their world headquarters are in Troy, Michigan, on the east side of the state, and they have locations all around the world. They have over 550 motivated accounting professionals, 90 years in business, and I mentioned the 10 offices worldwide. So if you want to connect and partner with one of the top CPA accounting and business firms in the world, they're right here in Michigan. Dorn Mayhew's Troy office on the east side of the state, and Josh Garvey is a managing shareholder for their Dorn Mayhew GR office. Right there by the S-curve, you'll see the new Dorn Mayhew sign. You can find out more. Just Google Dorn Mayhew. That's D-O-E-R-E-N-M-A-Y-H-E-W or Dorn.com. They're one of America's and the world's top CPA accounting and business firms. They're Dorn Mayhew.
Imagine this, winning big at Soaring Eagle. Luck is in the air with Soaring Eagle Casino and Resort's Big Money March Giveaway. Every Saturday from 5 p.m. to 10 p.m., play for the chance to win a share of $130,000 in cash and premium play. At 11 p.m. each night, one lucky Access Club member will take home $20,000 cash. Soaring Eagle Casino and Resort, your getaway reimagined. Visit SoaringEagleCasino.com for complete rules and details.
Roast Umber is a farm direct coffee sourced from Central American farmers and roasted in Grand Rapids. And also the Nitro Cold Brew Coffee is a convenient and healthy option for energy with no sugar additives. Look for it at your local retailer or at roastumber.com.
Miss any of today's show? Find our podcast and listen on demand on Google, Apple, Spotify, the iHeartRadio app, or wherever you get your podcasts. Now, back to X's and Bros with Anthony Bellino here on the Michigan Sports Network.
Welcome back here to X's and Bros, Michigan Sports Network. Great to have you ride along with us, no matter who you are, where you are, how you may be listening, all across the great state of Michigan and in Northwest Ohio and worldwide on the IR radio app. So great to have you ride along with us. Hopefully you heard our discussion with Kevin Pauga, diving into the numbers a little bit there. In hour number one, the KPI and the KenPom and Bart Torvik and how we even assemble this entire group for March Madness. I thought it was interesting. You know, it's the first four, and yeah, I had some documentation here. And, you know, what I was looking at was, did you know in 11 of the 12 tournaments that the first four has existed, at least one of those teams has advanced to the second round, at least one of them. Two have advanced to the final four. Three others have made the Sweet 16. In 2023, last year was the first time that two first four participants reached the second round with 11 seed Pitt and 16 seed FDU. Who doesn't remember them? Not only has a number 15 seed won a first round game in three consecutive years for the first time, but all three went on to reach the Sweet 16 as well. Princeton, St. Peter's, Oral Roberts the last 3 years. St. Peter's took it a step further, went to the Elite Eight. The number 15 seeds right now are 11 and 141. 11 and 141 in first-round games. Nine of those 11 winners finished in the top two in their conference standings. This year, South Dakota State, first in the Summit League, is the only 15 seed that finished in the top two in its conference. Maybe you'd be interested in dialing up a little SDSU. In the past five tournaments, 14 of the 20 matchups between number four and number 13 seeds were decided by single digits, the most of any first-round seed pairing. Surprisingly, only seven of the 20 matchups between the 8 and 9 seeds were single-digit games in the last 5 years. Oh, boy. 8-9. Got to be careful. Michigan State, Mississippi State. Does the winner of that game get the actual crown of MSU? Just a thought. Just throw it out there. At least one of the top four seeds has lost in the first round in 14 of the last 15 tournaments. Last year, there were three top four seeds that were done in their first game. Number one, Purdue. That was FDU. Number two, Arizona. Princeton offense. And number four, Virginia. Furman. Shout out to Furman. At least one 12 seed has defeated a five seed in 32 of the 38 tournaments. But this once sure thing is actually trending downwards. 12 seeds have failed to win a game just three times in the first 30 years of the modern era, but have come up short in three of the last eight tournaments. The 12-5 matchup you want to look out for this year, of course, is James Madison, the winningest team in college hoops, 31-3 in the regular season, taking on Wisconsin or Wisconsin, depending on whether or not you like T-Pain. How about this? In the second round, since 2008, the number three seeds are 22-5 against six seeds. From 85 to 2007, three seeds were 26-25 against the six seeds. So a little disparity there if we get a 3-6 matchup. A double-digit seed has advanced to the Sweet 16 in 15 consecutive tournaments and 36 out of 38 overall. Last year, the 15 seed at Princeton was the only double-digit seed to reach the second weekend. Four teams seeded 10th or worse reached the Sweet 16 in both 2021 and 2022. So just for, you know, some food for thought there. Now, when we look at the conferences, which has been a big big point of discussion because of Greg Sankey and his comments and, you know, how he is looking to basically add more Power 5 teams for more Power 5 revenue, which will not be, you know, it's the Power 6 in basketball, but they're also referred to as high majors. It just is confusing. The ACC has at least one team reach the Elite Eight in 34 of the last 38 tournaments. That's pretty special. That's pretty good. The Big 12 has had a team reach the title game in three of the last 4 years, including the champions in 2021 Baylor and 2022 Kansas. Kansas is prime for an upset. You know, if Hunter Dickinson's not available, I think Kansas is cooked. The Big Ten, since Tom Izzo's kids did it in 2000, haven't won a natty since. Obviously, everybody knows that. Just four Big Ten teams have reached the Sweet 16 in the past 3 years. the fewest in a three-year span since the 1996-1998 run. None of them have made a Final Four. How terrible is that in the last 3 years? The Coastal Athletic Conference, which was once known as the Colonial, but they had to change the name of the Colonial because Colonial's offensive. Don't get me started. They have not won a first-round game since VCU left the league in 2012. And now they'll have the Colonial Curse. That's what I'm going to call it. The Mountain West finally got past the Sweet 16 last year. But last year, with San Diego State becoming the first Mountain West team to get past the Sweet 16 and advance to the title game, Mountain West teams are 2-12 in the first round of the last seven tournaments. 2-12. Now, the Pac-12 has been 27 years since the Pac-12 to have a national championship, and this is it. Final chance for the Pac-12 to do anything because there is no more Pac-12 after this. I don't ask me what Washington State and Oregon State are going to do. If they want to remain with Pac-12, I don't know. Do you rebrand? Well, one thing I haven't heard yet. Do you rebrand the Mountain West as the Pac-12? Do you just bring all those teams in? Do you, instead of like adding Colorado State, or pardon me, Oregon State and Washington State to the Mountain West, do you just add all the Mountain West teams to the Pac-12? I mean, you already have the network. Like, you have infrastructure in place. Like, is that worth taking a look at? Should somebody be talking about that? Anybody? Just want to mention it? Throw that out there? You guys want to do it? Last time the Pac-12 had a national championship was 2006. Two Pac-12 teams in the last 15 years have reached the Final Four. Now let's get on to the SEC and Greg Sankey, the Sith Lord, the evil empire. Since 2016, none of the 17 teams out of the SEC have earned a top four seed, have reached the Final Four. None of them. The only two SEC teams to advance to the Final Four since 2016 were the number 5 Auburn team in 2019 and 7-seeded South Carolina in 2017. The last SEC team to reach a title game was an 8-seeded Kentucky in 2014. And this year, you've got Tennessee and Dalton Connect as a 2-seed. Kentucky's a 3-seed. Auburn and Alabama, the Iron Bowl, both 4-seeds. That's pretty interesting. I find that very, very interesting, actually. I don't really have any fun facts here for the Mid-American Conference. Ohio beating Virginia was probably what we'll hang our hat on, and we'll talk more with the coach, Kyle Barlow, about all of this. We'll deep dive into all of it as we have more first-round, first-four action coming up tonight. Another doubleheader. Boy, you know how nice it is to have a printer, by the way? Oh, dude, the printer changes the game. Changes the game when you can actually print and hold something instead of having to open up 8,000 tabs. Tabulations, right? Not necessarily ideal on the old laptop here. We've got a doubleheader of first four games after our two games last night with Virginia getting their doors blown off by Colorado State 67-42. Shout out to the Rams, CSU, Mountain West represent. It could be the MAC. It could be us. Five directional schools can listen to us right now. The Kalamazoo kids, Fire Up Chips, Eastern Michigan, Toledo Rockets, and Bowling Green. Five. The conference only has 12 teams, about to be 13 with the addition of UMass. That means that within our coverage range here on the Michigan Sports Network, covering all of Michigan and Northwest Ohio, we have damn near half of the league listening to us. That's why I talk about it so much. That and the fact that I've been employed by the teams in the Mid-American Conference since 2006. It's a long time. It's going on 20 years now, kid. But, you know, that'll change in the near future. But shout out to Colorado State and the Mountain West, doing it for the little guys. And then you had in the 16 seed, that was a battle of 10 seeds. In the 16 seeds, you had Wagner with a great game there, 71-68 over Howard. All those shots at the end, oh my goodness, just bricks everywhere. Wagner survives. You had number six, that's right? Yeah, 71-68. I did double check there. I was like, wait a minute, was that Howard or Wagner shooting the ball at the end? It was Howard. Howard couldn't hit the broadside of a barn. The clank everywhere. Doubleheader tonight, True TV. Check your local listings. Number 16, Grambling. In 16, Montana State at 640, followed up by a 10-seeded game between Colorado and Boise State. Both of those games in UD Arena. And then we get ready for tomorrow. Oh, baby, tomorrow, 12:15 CBS. 8-seed Mississippi State. 9-seed Michigan State from the Spectrum Center in Charlotte, North Carolina. That's going to be a lot of fun. And we'll get to all the rest of the games, tomorrow throughout the course of the show. Tons of college hoops because it's March, and why wouldn't we? But I do want to shift gears to what took place last night, Little Caesars Arena. Just write in MSU on your bracket, automatic winner. Not wrong. Just throw in the MSU there, and you can automatically win. Because you can't lose. I just want to know, does the winner of Mississippi State versus Michigan State, do they get to claim MSU now moving forward? I think that's relatively interesting. We've got Pizza Man and Blue Blob going at each other. I love that. That's good for all of us. That's a winner across the board. Speaking of winners across the board, Ben up in our 100.9 The Mitt, WLUN, news update desk. With a great tweet this morning, I literally just got done telling Freddie about Lucas Raymond. I know you have Patrick Kane. I get it. Lucas Raymond doesn't score that goal. We don't get into overtime. And Ben Boscher sends, Lucas Raymond has the most points in the NHL amongst players 21 years of age and younger. 25 points in the last 24 games. The guy he's a budding star. That's what he is. This guy is... I mean, that is an awesome selection. He was, what, the fourth pick, and then Mo Sider was the sixth pick, if I'm not mistaken, where they were drafted. This guy is a star, and they need every single one of his points every night because that first period was not good. Not good at all. And the coach, Derek Lalonde, was not happy about it either. I mean, he talked about it in his post game. He was not pleased. Here is Derek Lalonde talking about what took place when they went down 0-2 in that first period.
How much of what we saw in that first period gets washed away with the end result here tonight?
I don't know. I was flabbergasted. I was shocked, disappointed. I never thought with this group that it felt like they quit, and I couldn't believe it. We talked it through the first, and how much adversity and bounce back this group has shown this year, how much this group has shown in the 2 years I've been here. I couldn't believe it. And they didn't quit, obviously. Huge credit to the guys, the pushback in the second, and then obviously to hang in there and not to quit right to the end and get the full 2 points.
Huge. 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 Just like the huge show from 3 to 6 here on the Michigan Sports Network. I mean, that was, I don't even know, how to even describe how important that game was last night. Now, some people have taken to Twitter and said, hey, look, like this game, it's Columbus, man. It's the worst team in the league, or at least in the Eastern Conference. You're looking at a loss here with everything that's on the line. You're looking at a loss here that is utterly catastrophic. You go down 0-2, you battle back. Now, I am not as enthused as I was a few weeks ago. Boy, I came out of, calling that Red Wings Avalanche game 2-1 winner in OT. And I mean, I was like, holy mackerel. Mackerel. That's it. My buddy Gian thought like a mackerel, like a fish. He spelt it M-A-C-K space R-O-L-L, mackerel. So now I always tease him about that because he didn't know it was like holy mackerel. Holy mackerel. I was like, we're going to the playoffs. This is it. That was the first playoff game. And it was. That was a playoff game that took place. They went down, they tied it up, got a 2-1 winner in OT. It was sensational. And then Dylan Larkin got hurt. They went on that 7-game slide. And I'm telling you, garbage patch, trash patch curse. There is a... they miss Larkin, obviously. But also, at the same time, that 7-game streak sucked the life out of this fan base. I mean... This is what I'm talking about with the Lions. Here we go. Here's our parallel here. The Red Wings 7-game losing streak is exactly what is going to happen the first time the Lions lose a football game in 2024. Fire everybody. Everybody's a bum. Get rid of the GM. Sell the team. Right? The quick turn of emotion. Like there's supposed to be some buildup here. Right? There's got to be some buildup. You got to at least go out to dinner first. Right? You know what I mean? Build it up a little bit. You know? You people, the minute something goes wrong, the sky is falling, everything's on fire, you panic. You got it. We got it. And you can apply this to life and sport. You got to stop panicking. It doesn't do a good for anybody. They lose a game, they lose a game. Is it a concerning trend? Yes. Losing seven in a row, I'm not going to fire the head coach because your captain got injured and they lost seven games in a row. And Ben, up in our 100.9 WLUN, the MIT Research Department news desk here, Ben says the bad news is the team has an 866 team save percentage in the last 10 games. Well, there's a telltale right there. I mean, the goal from Columbus last night, you stripped the puck at the blue line. You got nobody behind you. One-on-one. Dude, you got to make a save. You have to. You know, we talked during that winning streak, and up until it was a two-month span, the entire month of January, the goaltending was out of this world. Right? Alex Lyon, like, oh, my God. Well, guess what? Everything kind of reverts back to the mean. Right? Pendulum swings a little bit. Some of the questions you had about who's going to be our starting goaltender in the beginning of the year, those ugly questions reared their ugly head during the seven-game losing streak. You lose seven games in a row, and everybody acts, they lose their minds. They lose their minds. What happens, like, in your real life when something goes wrong? Do you act like that? Do you literally just, hey, we've got a little bit of adversity here, and now we're just going to smash the panic button? What do you do? You got a grease fire in your kitchen. Like, what are you going to do? Are you going to be the person that goes and runs and gets the water? Or are you going to have baking soda? Like, do you not have baking soda in your house in the event that that might happen? Do you have a fire extinguisher? Or are you going to panic and let your house burn down because you couldn't handle the situation? Like, grow up. All of us. Every one of us. We have to do that in our day-to-day lives. Something bad is going to happen. Life is 90% of how you react to the 10% that's actually happening. So the team loses a few games and everyone's like, fire everybody, right? It doesn't make any sense. I'm telling you, the same thing is going to happen after the Lions' first loss. Oh, this team didn't do anything in free agency. Dan Campbell. Like, I love Colin Cowherd. I love the herd, right? He was talking about Dan Campbell as a coach and then talking about his recklessness. It's not reckless. If Josh Reynolds catches the football, we look back on our journey to the 2024 Super Bowl, Super Bowl 58 or whatever the hell, 57, whatever Super Bowl that was last year. I mean, we might as well call it the year of the Super Bowl because they trashed the logos on it. Every logo is the same now. Corporate synergy is stupid. But if Josh Reynolds catches that football, we're not talking about being reckless. We're talking about bold and courageous. It's all based on whether or not the play works out. Don't panic. Settle down. Good win last night. But a loss last night could have thrown the entire season off the rails because this team cannot afford to not win these games that are very winnable on their docket. Now, tonight, the Detroit Pistons. Detroit. 7 o'clock, taking on Tyrese Halliburton and the Pacers. Tune into that. The first four, we'll catch you tomorrow. Same time, same place. X's and Bros, Michigan Sports Network.
Time out. The Super Sale is back at Meijer, Friday and Saturday only. Coca-Cola 2 liters are $1.49. Frank's Red Hot Sauce is $2.99. And Pace Salsa is just $1.49. Plus, get chicken wings, pre-made snack trays, and fresh and ready deli items to enjoy during the games. Meijer's Super Sale deals are in-store and online while supplies last. Shop this Friday and Saturday only during the Meijer Super Sale. Okay, game on. Exclusions apply. See all the deals in the Meijer app.
Bill Simonson here for Flying Ace Craft Spirits. You can chart your own course with small batch American-made whiskeys. And also, they're connected to Folds of Honor here in Michigan, providing 4 scholarships this year through Flying Ace Craft Spirits to the children of men and women injured or killed in combat. Look for Flying Ace Craft Spirits and that small batch American-made whiskeys in different flavors at local stores, or ask for it at your local pub, bar, or restaurant. Flying Ace exists at the intersection of independence and precision. They distill fine spirits for mavericks, the adventurous, the cunning, and the bold.
You can find out more and also order online if you're 21 and up at flyingacespirits.com or look for it in stores all across Michigan or at your local bar, pub, or restaurant.